Kawan Dallas University committed to becoming the agent of the earthening or making constitution down to earth conducted by academic society. Ladies and gentlemen, in general, Pusako has two categories of activities: research and study, and socialization and dissemination of ideas and culture on constitution. In the field of research and study, one of the major activities of Pusako is the National Conference of Constitutional Law. This year's conference will be the third conference. The result of the research and study up to this moment have been published in the form of scientific journals, books, and other kinds of publications. In fact, over the coming months, Pusako and IFES Indonesia will cooperate in research project on the reform of political parties. And this research result will be a major discussion in the next National Conference of Constitutional Law in September this year. Insyaallah will be held in Bukit Tinggi. Meanwhile, in the term of socialization and dissemination of idea and culture of constitution, Pusako conducts two major events: the annual Muhammad Yamin Constitutional Award and Constitutional Weeks of Pekan Konstitusi. The Yamin Award is aimed at appreciating, acknowledging the person who have made a major contribution to advancement of the Constitution and constitutionalism, while the Pekan Konstitusi is intended to spread the notion, ideas, and value of constitution to the student of senior high school in Sumatra or region Sumatra. This year, the Muhammad Yamin Constitutional Award will be conducted for the second and the Pekan Konstitusi for the next time. Besides the recent relative activities, Pusako is also active in cooperating with this many state institutions such as Constitutional Court, Supreme Court, House of Representatives, Council of Regional Representatives, Judicial Commission, Corruption Eradication Commission, Ministry of Law and Human Rights, etc. These corporations are performing focus group discussion, seminar, international on national level seminar, research on judiciary verdicts, up to monitoring of the corruption trials. Ladies and gentlemen, actually, there are still plenty to tell you all about the Pusako. However, the committee insists that this introduction shall be very brief and concise. And before we pay our full attention to the presentation of Dr. Waliki, as requested by the committee, I would like to make a short introduction about the Dr. Marcin Waliki as our single speaker today. Dr. Marcin Waliki is the head of Democratization Department of Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, OSCE, Office for Democratic Institutions and Human Rights. Dr. Waliki has worked on the anti-corruption and political finance, political party regulation, among other issues, in more than 40 countries. He has over 18 years of democracy assistance and governance experience. Before joining the OSCE Office for Democratic Institutions and Human Rights, he was the executive director of the Brussels Best European Partnership for Democracy, and I'm a senior advisor for political finance in Washington, D.C. Dr. Waliki was also consultant to or conducted OSCE program, European Council, European Union, Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, United Nations Democracy Fund, Canadian government, U.S. government, and some other government of transitional state. Dr. Waliki was born in Poland. The Poland is quite similar with Indonesia, Dr. Waliki. The difference is the color of the flag. Indonesia above the red and the white in under. In Poland, the above is white, the red is under. Dr. Waldi accomplished his PhD program in philosophy and politics at the St. Anthony's College, Oxford University, one of the best universities in the world, I think. Is it correct, eh? And Dr. Waldi accomplished his master's degree in law and constitutional law in Warsaw University. He has written many publications on democratization and democratic governance. Before entering this building, we made a very small discussion. Is it possible, the possibilities to join a writing with some our lecture in Andalas University, especially issues on political party reform. Dan Dr. Waleki ready for this proposal. Ladies and gentlemen and distinguished guests, on behalf of all participants, allow me to invite to the podium for delivering his speech, the learned and distinguished Dr. Waleki. Dr. Waleki, this podium and the time is yours. Thank you very much. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Distinguished professors, fellow academics, representatives of political parties, lecture administration, ladies and gentlemen, good morning.
Akademia yang terhormat, perwakilan partai politik, dan saudara-saudari sekalian, selamat pagi.
It is a great pleasure. Thank you very much indeed for your kind invitation. I have to say, coming to the university, seeing the huge billboard in the front of the university and the huge billboard behind me, I know where I'm going to ask for help when I decide to run for president of Poland.
Saya berterima kasih sekali atas undangannya dan saya merasa sangat terhormat untuk hadir di sini. Saya rasa setelah melihat poster yang sangat besar di depan juga di belakang saya saat ini, saya tahu saya harus minta dukungan ke siapa ketika saya akan menjadi presiden Polandia.
Great billboard, terrible photo.
Spanduknya bagus, tapi fotonya jelek sekali.
What I'm going to do today, with the very limited time we have, I'm not going to give you long, boring lecture. As you know, power corrupts, PowerPoint corrupts absolutely. So let's just use the PowerPoint which you will see as an invitation to a broader discussion. And I would really like you to ask questions, make comments, during my lecture, and I promise to leave some time at the end of it.
Dengan waktu kita yang sangat terbatas, saya tidak ingin menyampaikan hanya sebuah kuliah biasa. Seperti yang kita ketahui, kekuasaan itu mengkorupsi, PowerPoint juga mengkorupsi lebih marak lagi. Jadi tolong, PowerPoint yang Anda lihat di depan ini akan kita gunakan saja sebagai undangan untuk melihat diskusi yang lebih terbuka.
In my brief presentation, I will share with you experience from number of countries where I worked on political party reforms, political party regulation reforms. I'm going to take you to a dark side of politics. I'm also going to talk about challenges which political parties are facing, and I promise we will try to arrive at some conclusions, lessons learned.
Kuliah ini saya akan menyampaikan kepada Anda pengalaman saya ketika saya bekerja dalam bidang reformasi partai politik dan peraturan partai politik, dan saya akan membawa Anda ke dalam sisi gelap dari partai politik, dan saya harap diskusi ini dapat berguna untuk kita semua.
It's not a secret, I assume most of the people in this room do not love political parties, but we still have to respect them, because there is actually no alternative at the current moment for how we can function as modern democracy. Political parties are necessary for modern democracy.
memang bukan rahasia lagi bahwa mungkin dari antara kita semua tidak ada yang benar-benar mencintai partai politik. Tetapi tidak ada alternatifnya untuk demokrasi modern saat ini. Partai politik adalah diperlukan untuk mendukung demokrasi.
And they perform number of functions. I'm not going to go into all of them, but a very important representative function, but equally important governing function. You know, you cannot run any democracy without political parties.
Dan mereka memiliki berbagai fungsi yang tidak semuanya akan saya bahas. Dan salah satu fungsinya adalah fungsi perwakilan. Tapi selain itu, fungsinya juga adalah fungsi pemerintahan. Tidak ada pemerintahan demokratis yang dapat berjalan tanpa partai politik.
They're also the best platform for collective expression of fundamental human rights. If you want to organize yourself, if you want to express your views, if you want to organize a rally, your natural organization would be a political party.
Dan ini juga, partai politik juga merupakan saluran yang paling baik untuk menyampaikan pendapat dan aspirasi Anda. Jika Anda ingin menyampaikan aspirasi Anda, mengekspresikan pendapat Anda, dan membawanya ke dalam ranah politik, maka partai politik adalah hal terbaik yang dapat Anda gunakan untuk berekspresi.
But I would like us to focus on their rights and their responsibilities, and I'm going to show you some trends which we've noticed in many European countries. And we will arrive at the conclusion that political parties are in trouble.
Dan yang akan saya lakukan sekarang adalah saya akan membahas hak-hak mereka dan tanggung jawab mereka. Lalu saya akan membahas tren-tren yang ada dan kita akan sampai kepada kesimpulan bahwa partai politik saat ini sedang bermasalah.
Let's start first of all with looking at some recent trends. Some people would argue that we see decline in democracies, democratic recession. You see, looking at the chart, you will see that since 2006, number of countries where quality of democracy is improving is significantly lower than number of countries where quality of democracy is declining.
Dapat dikatakan bahwa kualitas demokrasi saat ini sedang menurun. Jika Anda lihat gambarnya, grafiknya, maka Anda bisa lihat bahwa jumlah negara-negara yang kualitas demokrasinya naik itu jauh lebih sedikit daripada jumlah negara-negara yang kualitas demokrasinya turun.
Also, if you look at the growth of democracy, how many countries are in transition towards democracy and in transition towards authoritarian systems, you will see that especially in Eastern Europe, you know, there is a stagnation. You know, we do not have a major growth of countries moving towards democracy.
Jika Anda melihat juga di negara-negara transisi yang bergerak menuju demokrasi dibandingkan dengan negara-negara yang bergerak menuju rezim otoriter, maka Anda bisa melihat bahwa terutama di Eropa Timur mulai ada mulai stagnan jumlah negara-negara yang menuju demokrasi.
It is important for us to understand political parties are operating in a difficult environment, and this environment is even becoming more difficult in some new democracies.
Penting untuk kita melihat bahwa partai politik itu bekerja dalam lingkungan yang sangat sulit, dan lingkungan itu menjadi lebih sulit lagi dalam demokrasi-demokrasi yang masih muda.
Political parties are also facing a major problem when it comes to perception, when it comes to level of trust, and what we think about political parties.
Partai politik juga melihat mengalami masalah dalam hal persepsi, tingkat kepercayaan, dan pendapat publik tentang partai politik.
Okay, please raise your hands who really loves political parties, who thinks about them as a great organization. Raise your hands.
Tolong angkat tangan Anda jika Anda merasa bahwa partai politik itu luar biasa baik sekali dan Anda mencintai partai politik.
Thank you very much. You know, one brave woman. Yes, thank you.
Terima kasih, ada satu perempuan yang sungguh sangat berani.
The truth is that in many European countries, political parties are perceived as the most corrupt democratic institutions. In fact, if you ask parents about the ideal job for their children, being a politician is a name on the last position.
Di Eropa, partai politik itu termasuk sangat tidak populer dan sangat tidak dipercaya dan dianggap yang paling korup di antara institusi-institusi demokrasi lainnya. Jika Anda bertanya kepada seorang orang tua, apa kerjaan untuk anak Anda yang Anda inginkan, mereka tidak akan menyebutkan politisi.
There are, in many European countries, there are more people who believe that there is life on Mars than they trust political parties.
Di negara-negara Eropa lebih banyak orang yang percaya bahwa ada kehidupan di planet Mars dibandingkan dengan orang-orang yang percaya dengan partai politik.
In Spain, Greece, and Italy, less than 8% of people trust political parties.
Di Spanyol, Yunani, dan Italia, kurang dari 8% orang-orang yang percaya pada partai politik.
I heard that in Indonesia it's a level of 16%, so you're not doing that bad.
Saya dengar di Indonesia level kepercayaannya kurang lebih 16%, jadi itu sebenarnya tidak buruk-buruk amat.
So when you look at political parties, indeed, they are perceived by most of the citizens as corrupt institutions, and I cannot name any single country in Europe which would not go for a major corruption scandal over the last 10-20 years.
Dan maka melihat ini semuanya, memang partai politik itu dianggap sebagai institusi-institusi yang paling korup. Dan saya tidak bisa menyebutkan negara Eropa manapun yang selama 20 tahun terakhir tidak mengalami skandal korupsi.
And I will go back to this issue because it's very closely connected with the way political parties are financed and lack of transparency, lack of accountability when it comes to funding of political parties.
Dan saya akan membahas kembali isu ini karena ini terkait tepat dengan isu pendanaan partai politik dan cara partai politik didanai serta transparansinya.
Another symptom of the weakness of political parties is major decline in party membership, which we observe in many European countries.
Gejala lainnya yang terjadi pada partai politik adalah penurunan besar akan jumlah anggota partai yang kita lihat banyak di negara-negara Eropa.
Okay. Please raise your hand who used to be or is a member of political party.
Tolong angkat tangan Anda jika Anda pernah menjadi atau saat ini sedang sebagai anggota partai politik.
I used to be a member, yes.
Saya
David,
dulu.
Thank you very much.
David, terima kasih.
Honestly, only two of us, David and me.
Masa cuma dua saja, David dan saya saja?
It is very important, and I'll go back to it. You know, party membership, you cannot have a well-functioned parties. You cannot have a democratic party without a membership.
Ini memang sangat penting dan akan saya bahas kembali nanti. Anda tidak bisa memiliki sebuah partai politik yang demokratis tanpa anggota.
But if you look at what is happening in Europe, a major decline in party membership.
Tapi jika Anda melihat Eropa, penurunan jumlah anggota partai itu sangat besar.
We do not have a mass parties described by Diverger many years ago. We do not have mass parties anymore in Europe.
Kita tidak memiliki partai-partai besar lagi di Eropa seperti yang dideskripsikan oleh Diverger bertahun-tahun yang lalu.
You will actually see that in, you know, this is a global trend. I was surprised to see that the biggest decline was actually in New Zealand.
Anda akan melihat bahwa ini adalah tren yang cukup global dan saya justru terkejut melihat bahwa penurunan paling besar ada di Selandia Utara, Selandia Baru.
Another trend which really worries me, and if you could see slide the one the chart at the bottom. This is the membership in different European countries. It's very low. Starting with my own country, Poland, it's less than 1%. It's not only that membership is low. If you then check what is the membership when it comes to young people, you will see that young people are not joining political parties.
Ini juga tren yang cukup mengkhawatirkan. Anda lihat grafik yang ada di bawah. Itu adalah jumlah keanggotaan partai-partai politik di Eropa, mulai dari negara saya, Polandia. Dan bukan hanya jumlahnya yang sedikit, tetapi jika Anda lihat juga, jumlah anak muda yang bergabung dalam partai politik juga sangat kecil.
For those of you who are familiar with the theory of circulation of elites, you know, where the parties are going to take new leaders from?
Jika Anda cukup kenal teori sirkulasi elit, maka dari manakah partai politik dapat mendapatkan pemimpin baru mereka?
Where will the people who supposed to run the country come from?
Dari manakah akan ada orang-orang yang seharusnya menjalankan negara ini?
So you see the problem, you know, on one hand, representative functional parties, we have a major problem in many European countries because most of you, young people, are not represented and there are many decisions being taken about you, how the educational system should be designed, how the pension system should be designed, how the labor regulations should support young people. You are not taken into consideration when decisions are made.
Dan ini menjadi masalah karena jika Anda lihat fungsi representasi dari partai politik, anak-anak muda seperti Anda semua tidak diwakili oleh partai politik. Padahal ada banyak sekali keputusan-keputusan politik yang berkaitan dengan Anda, misalnya sistem pendidikan, sistem pensiun di masa depan, peraturan-peraturan ketenaga kerjaan yang akan mempengaruhi Anda.
So key decisions which affect you are made without you.
Jadi keputusan-keputusan penting yang adalah tentang Anda dibuat tanpa perwakilan Anda.
Second problem is the governing function of parties. How will the parties fill very important positions in the government, in the local government, national government, in all the organizations which they need to implement their policies? Where are young, educated people who understand global world? They are not in political parties.
Fungsi keduanya adalah fungsi pemerintahan. Bagaimana caranya sebuah partai dapat menjalankan sebuah negara jika di institusi-institusi besar yang berkaitan dengan fungsi mereka tidak ada orang-orang muda yang memahami situasi global dan situasi pemerintahan saat ini?
Right now in Europe, when it comes to party membership, only 2% of young people are members of political parties.
Saat ini di Eropa, jika Anda melihat keanggotaan partai, hanya 2% anak-anak muda yang tergabung dalam partai politik.
In some parties, like a British Conservative Party, the average age of members is 68.
Di beberapa partai-partai, misalnya Partai Konservatif Inggris, umur rata-rata anggotanya adalah 68.
I'm pretty sure they have a lot of fun there, but they don't really represent society.
Saya yakin mereka banyak banyak politisnya, tetapi mereka tidak mewakili demografi pada saat ini.
The next trend, which is equally worrying, is declining participation in elections.
Trend berikutnya juga mengkhawatirkan adalah menurunnya partisipasi dalam pemilu.
You will see in many European countries that frustration is expressed through participation online, young people going to the streets. They are not using traditional democratic institutions to express their strong views.
Anda akan melihat bahwa ketika anak-anak muda frustrasi, mereka melampiaskannya secara online atau demo di jalanan, tetapi mereka tidak menggunakan jalur-jalur tradisional demokrasi untuk menyampaikan kekesalan mereka.
Especially among young people and other groups, participation in elections is declining. Many people do not believe that elections will change anything.
Terutama dalam pemilu, partisipasi anak-anak muda itu menurun. Banyak orang yang tidak percaya bahwa pemilu itu bisa mengubah sesuatu.
Okay, I don't want to depress you. I mean, yes, indeed, we have some key challenges as all democracies globally. And we need to realize that part of those challenges result from the fact that political parties are weak.
Tapi saya tidak ingin membuat Anda depresi. Saya lihat bahwa memang banyak sekali tantangan-tantangan, tetapi tantangan-tantangan ini dapat dihadapi.
And what we've seen over the last 50 years, particularly over the last 20 years, number of regulations being introduced to revert to address some of those negative developments.
Dan yang kita lihat dalam 20-15 tahun terakhir ada berbagai peraturan yang dibuat untuk menangani masalah-masalah tersebut.
Especially in the area of party funding. Over the last 20 years we've seen almost all European countries going through the major reforms when it comes to the way parties are financed.
Terutama area pendanaan politik. Dalam beberapa tahun terakhir kita melihat ada berbagai peningkatan-peningkatan peraturan terutama terkait dengan pendanaan politik.
And I would like to provoke you, I would like to get your opinion. Why do you think we need to regulate the way parties are financed? Why we need to make sure that parties are not captured by few very rich individuals who are creating oligarchic structures to run our countries?
Dan saya ingin memprovokasi Anda dan bertanya kepada Anda, mengapa penting untuk kita mengatur pendanaan partai politik? Mengapa penting untuk kita melihat bahwa partai-partai tidak didanai oleh donor-donor besar saja?
And you will hear from me again, one of the key principles here is a very simple phrase. Either democracy controls money, or money will control democracy.
Dan Anda akan mendengar dari saya bahwa ada sebuah kalimat yang dapat menjelaskan ini dengan tepat, yaitu antara demokrasi mengontrol uang atau uang mengontrol demokrasi.
You will see later on, I'll show you how we're trying to make parties more transparent, more accountable when it comes to funding political parties.
Saya akan tunjukkan kepada Anda nanti bagaimana caranya membuat partai-partai lebih transparan dan akuntabel dalam pendanaan.
But one thing I would like to make clear, working in more than 40 countries, I keep saying you cannot just cut and paste regulations from one country and introduce them in another country. The regulations dealing with political parties need to reflect your constitutional tradition, your political culture, and they need to be country specific.
Tapi seperti yang setelah saya pelajari di lebih dari 40 negara, tidak mungkin Anda hanya mengcopy paste saja peraturan dari negara lain lalu Anda terapkan di negara Anda. Peraturan-peraturan perlu untuk melihat tradisi konstitusi Anda, konteks lokal Anda, dan terutama kondisi situasi negara Anda.
Especially for new democracies, countries which went for a democratic transition, there are three principles, three issues I would like you to keep in mind. Number one is you don't want to go back to totalitarian state with super control over political parties. Any legislation should minimize control of political functions. Parties need to stay autonomous.
Dan saya akan menyebutkan tiga hal yang sangat penting, terutama untuk negara-negara yang sedang bertransisi ke dalam demokrasi. Yang pertama adalah, kita tidak ingin kembali ke rezim yang otoriter. Partai harus diatur sesedikit mungkin dan diberikan kebebasan sebanyak mungkin.
We've seen many problems of over-regulated parties, and parties losing control as a result of a strict regulation, strict control coming from not always democratic state.
Kita melihat banyak kondisi-kondisi yang terjadi akibat terlalu banyak peraturan bagi partai sehingga partai kehilangan kendali dan mereka tidak memiliki kekuatan lagi.
We need to make sure that state agencies, state bodies which are controlling political parties, either their registration, their funding, the way they operate, are truly independent and they do it to support political pluralism. Main principle is not to harm, to support, to galvanize political pluralism, not to undermine it.
Dan kita ingin melihat di terutama institusi-institusi yang mengatur partai-partai politik, entah dari pendaftarannya, pendanaannya, dan operasi mereka, mereka perlu untuk independen dan mereka juga harus mendukung kemajuan politik.
Some other very important principles, but I'll go through them quickly. You know, the issue of interventions, proportionality, make sure that you only regulate those things which need to be regulated, you leave remaining things to internal party bylaws, party statutes, and party constitution.
Dan kita perlu melihat juga, terutama prinsip-prinsipnya secara singkat adalah prinsip intervensi atau proportionalisme, dan ini perlu ditekankan bahwa pada peraturan-peraturan tertentu kita perlu meninggalkan ruang untuk partai untuk meregulasi dalam diri mereka sendiri secara internal, entah dari ADART-nya atau dari konstitusi partainya.
Okay. And then if we try to move to the issue of internal party democracy, probably the issue which is the most interesting for many of you is how should parties select their leaders and candidates?
Dan salah satu isu yang penting dalam dan isu yang saya yakin Anda ingin tahu juga tentang demokrasi internal partai adalah bagaimana cara partai memilih pemimpinnya.
It is going to be one of the key discussions. I'm going to take the next 5 minutes to focus on the issue of leadership selection, gender equality, and funding of political parties. And then I will finish talking about how should the control over political parties be exercised. But the issue of leadership selection, you could also apply some of those rules to candidate selection, is a fundamental for the functioning of any political party.
Saya akan menghabiskan waktu 5 menit ke depan untuk berbicara tentang bagaimana cara memilih sebuah pimpinan partai politik, kesetaraan gender, dan juga pendanaan politik. Dan setelah itu saya akan selesai berbicara tentang cara mengatur partai politik. Tetapi elemen pertama yang penting adalah bagaimana cara memilih pimpinan partai politik.
You can answer this question yourself. What happens when you have a very small group of people selecting a leader? This would be just a confirmation of Mitchell's golden rule of oligarchy, iron rule of oligarchy. If you do not have a strong membership, if you only allowed top people to select top leader,